students and teachers for the reception tonight. Let's give them a round of applause. We're going to call our school board meeting to order, and if you're sitting towards the back and have had one of my children as a student, you're going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Ms. Carter, would you please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance tonight?
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very, very much for that. Ms. Callahan, will you please take roll call? And do we have a motion to adopt the agenda?
Mr. Chair, I motion that the agenda be adopted.
Second. There's been a motion and a second that the agenda be adopted as written. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, no. And the motion passes. At this time, we'd like to take a moment of silence for Fred Parker, a former employee who passed away on January 4th. Mr. Parker worked at Coleman and was the first elementary physical education teacher in the county. Our thoughts and prayers are with his family. Please join me for a moment of silence. Thank you. And at this time, we are going to move to the presentation of why most of you are here tonight, which is the Washington Post Teacher of the Year nominees. Dr. Jack and Ms. Grove, our vice chairman, will lead us in this. And yeah, when your name is read,
yes.
Right now?
All the nominees, if you would come forward at this time.
Great, all the nominees, please come forward.
We'll get you there. Okay, that everybody? Okay, we're going to start with Susan Ayler, and I guess if you would wave or step out or something so we know. There you go. Susan Ayler has the unique ability to command respect for herself and others and challenge her students at Grace Miller to strive for excellence, all the while leaving her students with the knowledge that she cares for each one of them deeply. She teaches her students that learning is fun. A colleague writes that this 25-year veteran teacher is an outstanding example of what the teaching profession looks like. A former student, now a senior in college, said she wishes all teachers would make math as easy to understand as Mrs. Ayler did. Her principal, Mr. Adkins, writes that she has a calling to teach. One parent and colleague said they felt they had won the lottery when they learned their daughter was going to have Mrs. Ayler for her fourth grade teacher. She added that when she sought advice from Mrs. Ayler, she was completely honest and her responses focused on what was best for the children. Mrs. Ayler's support for her students does not end in the classroom. For the past several years, she has led a small group tutoring session, free of charge, at least once a week. A parent writes that it was Mrs. Ayler's efforts that gave her daughter the desire to succeed in school, but it is Mrs. Ayler's dedication and heart that makes her such a blessing to every child that crosses her path. Congratulations, Susan. Jessica Beach. There she is. Jessica Beach has a love and passion for students and art, and she helps her students at Brumfield see the art in everything. She teaches her students to express their feelings through art, giving them encouragement and guiding them to believe they are all artists in their own right. Mrs. Gannon, Brumfield's principal, writes that she motivates her students to want to excel and takes a genuine interest in their lives. One student writes that he thought art was just for girls, but then Ms. Beats made art seem really fun, and now he even colors at home. Ms. Beach demonstrates her strong leadership skills in her role on the Positive Behavioral Intervention and Supports Team, Behavioral Assistance Team, and her dedication and efforts to Youth Art Month. Ms. Beach was selected the Virginia Art Education Association Elementary Art Teacher of 2015. A parent writes that what sets Ms. Beach apart from others is the contributions that she makes outside of the classroom, the ways she goes above and beyond for her students, and the joyful impact she instills on those around her, and that joy comes from her art. Congratulations. Terrell Budd, Fauquier High School's child development instructor, engages her students in lessons that are typical in the daycare environment. Vice Principal Mr. Kellican writes that Ms. Budd worked diligently to develop a child care program, Falcon Teens and Tots, that is extremely popular with the students and receives accolades from the community. This program provides students with hands-on activities and the opportunity to teach preschool children. Parents have such confidence in her preschool program that there is a waiting list every year. Ms. Budd's expectations of her students are high, and the students have demonstrated that they are eager to meet the challenges laid before them. Ms. Budd is a board member and treasurer of the Fauquier Sports Foundation and helps organize many youth wrestling events. Wrestlers stop by her room daily for a snack before practice or just to say hi to Mama Budd. A parent and colleague writes that his son had Ms. Budd when she was a third grade teacher, and now his now 20-year-old son still regards Ms. Budd as his favorite teacher. He adds that the success of Mrs. Budd's students are a testament to Mrs. Budd and her program. Congratulations. Amy Kakowski is not only a fifth grade teacher at Bradley, but also the fifth grade team chairperson and an advisor for the Positive Behavioral Intervention and Supports Program and a PTO vice president. She demonstrates the need to be a lifelong learner for her students and challenges herself by making frequent grade level changes. Her colleagues find her ability to engage her students to be one of her most compelling attributes. Bradley Principal Mrs. Banks writes that in the 7 years Mrs. Kakowski has been at Bradley, she has demonstrated her ability to lead, mentor, and coach her colleagues. A parent writes that her daughter has not complained one day this school year, hard to believe, about going to school because she knows that a great day awaits her in Mrs. Kakowski's class. Mrs. Kakowski is described by her colleagues as the whole package. She goes the extra mile to engage her students and shares best evidence-based practices for student outcomes and core instruction with her colleagues. A student writes, Mrs. Kakowski is a super sweet teacher and amazing. She is always there for me when I need someone to talk to, and she puts a smile on my face every day. Congratulations.
Kimberly Carter has been a Warrenton Middle School math teacher for 18 years, and according to her principal, Mrs. Bannister, has had success in the classroom since her arrival. Her quiet, unassuming manner and her willingness to help every student find their math ability is rewarded with students who trust her implicitly and find confidence in themselves. Mrs. Carter is accommodating to her students as well as to her colleagues, evidenced by giving up planning time and staying after school to help not only her students, but other students, and by changing classrooms and grade levels for newly hired teachers. Wow. Her student comments are too numerous to mention this evening, but they range from those who went from an F to a B in her math class because of her tenacity to explain a concept until the student understood, to students who do not struggle with math and are honor students, but respect Mrs. Carter's methods to create a clear path to their success. A colleague writes, "There are two kinds of people in the world, those that embrace numerical calculations with speed and accuracy, and those that avoid anything that remotely looks like a number." Kim Carter is the math teacher who makes every student feel success in math. Blair Connor, who taught math at LHS for 9 years, is another teacher whose accolades from her current and former students are many. Their letters are peppered with words such as smart, kind, mentor, and patient. Students write that she never gives up on them, and she establishes a community in her classroom with students helping each other. Dr. Margaret Wise, assistant professor of special education at George Mason, met Mrs. Connor through her research in co-teaching. She observed Mrs. Connor and Mrs. Linebaugh co-teaching in math as participants in the Virginia Department of Education's co-teaching initiative. Dr. Wise wrote that Mrs. Connor embodies the traits of an exemplary teacher, dedication to the profession, and to her students, continuous reflection on and the learning about instruction, willingness to support research and future teachers, and enthusiasm for everything she does every day. LHS principal writes that Mrs. Connor's tireless energy and positive attitude influences everyone's journey at LHS. And Liberty's SCA president writes that Mrs. Connor has been a reminder of the importance of kindness and the difference one can make by being friendly to others. Wow. Ellie Kay. Ellie Kay moved into her position at PB Smith as lead reading teacher this year with the same mindset she originally entered into teaching, to continuously perfect her skills and knowledge to enhance her learning environment and the environment of those she works with. I know I'm not supposed to end a sentence with a preposition. Sorry. Mrs. K is not only an example of an outstanding teacher, but also a good example in risk-taking and humility. She is not afraid to try new methods to reach every student and is not afraid to share what does not work, as well as what does work with her colleagues. Her principal, Mrs. Smith, writes, "Ellie K is the quintessential teacher. She loves her students and her students love her back. She is great at what she does and refuses to accept anything less than excellence from herself and her students." Former principal Dr. Comstock, who worked with Mrs. K for 9 years, writes that her strong relationships with her students and their families is a natural result of her knowledge and love of each child. Dr. Comstock pays Mrs. K high praise when she adds that she would be thrilled if each of her grandchildren could have Mrs. K as a teacher. Wow, very nice. Karen Martin. Karen Martin loves teaching special education at Coleman and is an advocate for her students, keeping up with the current laws and rights of the children for which she is responsible. Mrs. Carter, assistant principal, writes that she has worked with many teachers during her 35 years in public education. However, few teachers have inspired her in the manner that Karen Martin has. Mrs. Martin introduces her lessons in a way that brings excitement and curiosity to each student. Observing Mrs. Martin read a chapter book to her students is spellbinding, as she takes on the voice of the persona of each character in such a way that her students can see the character in their own minds and then become part of the story. She has the ability to write IEPs that target the academic strengths and weaknesses of her students, as well as their overall personal and relational needs, and then to focus on their multiple IEP throughout the day in her classroom, multiple IEPs throughout the day in her classroom. Mrs. Martin can often be seen at parades, carnivals, and other events that include her students. Her instructional aide, Mrs. Cook, writes that Karen always has a smile on her face and for her students, and her love of teaching them is admirable and deserves celebration.
Helen Olinger. There she is. Oh. My pages are swapped. Yes. Kim Mathias has developed one of the best middle school agriculture FFA programs at Cedar Lea in the state of Virginia and possibly the entire United States, according to her principal, David Lea. I think I agree also. He writes that she loves being a teacher and a mentor. She loves her subject and the FFA. And most of all, she loves her students, who are dedicated, enthusiastic, polite, and knowledgeable. A colleague writes that the school campus has fresh garden beds and new planters thanks to Ms. Mathias' leadership and the pride her students take in their work. Mrs. Ganzert, with the International Organization for Women Educators, writes that Ms. Mathias excels in the classroom while she successfully leads a statewide organization of nearly 2,000 teachers as the Virginia State President. A special education teacher at Cedar Lea writes that Kim offered to teach her students during her one and only planning period one day a week. The students are in charge of setting up the classroom, filling the watering cans, watering the plants, and feeding classroom pets. Nobody is ever left out. The faces of the special needs students when they see their ag buddies in the hall is priceless, and general education students learn patience, understanding, and the importance of being open-minded and kind. Congratulations, Kim. Just a little quick story. I was helping my daughter at the florist today, and this lady came in and wanted a wrapped bouquet for her friend who was getting a presentation of an award tonight. So we fixed something that I hoped was very nice. And when I walked in, that lady was standing there beside Kim with that bouquet of flowers. So I hope they were okay, Kim. Jessica Murphy, a Kettle Run High School AP psychology and sociology teacher, challenges her students to learn. In a highly unusual nomination letter, a former student writes that although he did not pass Mrs. Murphy's class, what he learned from her he will carry for the rest of his life, hoping to grow in that knowledge and share it with others along the way. He credits Mrs. Murphy with opening a realm in the universe that he didn't believe existed and giving him an in-depth look into the human mind. Wow. Her students love her class, writing that she genuinely cares about them, and her goodness and motivation to do her job at the highest level of performance makes her the gold standard for any aspiring educator. Many students wrote that she is their favorite, or one of the most effective teachers they have had. Mrs. Murphy's colleagues share the same respect and admiration for her, noting her talent to simplify the most complex concept, her nurturing nature, and her knowledge and sense of humor. They write that she brings real-world examples to her students through many of her former experiences as a police officer. The impact she has on her students is evidenced during the holidays when students home from college fill her room just to visit. Congratulations. Helen Olinger's evaluation following her first school year at Pearson in 1996 stated that she demonstrates excellent ability as a teacher, providing a colorful, enriching, interesting, and fun learning atmosphere for the children. In her 20 years of teaching, Mrs. Olinger continues to be an exemplary teacher as well as a mentor, taking new teachers under her wing. Pearson's principal, Ms. Wilcox, writes that Mrs. Olinger is a leader, not only for her grade level, but the whole school. She looks for new ways to teach and reach her students, always open to new and innovative ways of teaching, while showing her young students good old-fashioned love. A parent whose child has been diagnosed with autism and ADHD writes that her child has flourished in Mrs. Olinger's third grade class due to her flexibility to use varying methods to reach him. She adds that Mrs. Olinger is an amazing teacher and a great example to other FCPS employees and teachers across the country. Her co-teacher writes that she is determined, knowledgeable, loyal, and always puts her students above everything else. Mrs. Olinger is humble in her collaborations and partnerships, yet steady in her beliefs of best practices, and is a remarkable colleague, role model, and friend. Congratulations, Helen. Barb Rich's classroom at Taylor Middle School is full of engaged, smiling, energetic children who are doing their best to meet or exceed her expectations of them. She has been teaching for 35 years and is a former special education teacher. She brings a unique perspective and is able to differentiate her math lessons to reach all learners in the classroom. A colleague writes that Ms. Rich has a way of opening up the world of math to a child, and they start to see it and understand it with new eyes. They go from hating math to loving it. There is mutual love and respect between teacher and students, which is obvious when anyone observes her class. Ms. Rich's department chair writes that she is a household name for many in the community, and is continually requested by parents to be their child's teacher. She is relaxed, encouraging, and fun, yet purposely prepared each day. Ms. Rich knows not to sweat the small stuff and keep her eye on the prize, the students. Her principal, Ms. Nelson, has worked with Ms. Rich since 1994 and writes that she is held in high esteem by her fellow teachers, school and central office administrators, parents, students, and the community at large. Another colleague writes that Ms. Rich was assigned to be her mentor 21 years ago, and she was God sent then and still is today. Congratulations, Barb.
Annalisa Lisa Stafford. Lisa. That's right, Lisa and the Cult Jam. I was trying to think there was a group. I'm like, we are dating ourselves. Desire to be a rock star might not have come true in the sense most of us think about a rock star, but she certainly seems to be a star to her colleagues and students at Mary Walter Elementary School. Her principal, Mr. Odell, writes that her classroom is a fun place where anything is possible and students help and encourage each other. She is not just a coach, she is in the game. Mrs. Stafford believes it is okay to fail. It is not okay to stumble. It is okay to stumble. Thank you. The not okay part is the quitting part. It is not okay to quit. In spite of her star persona, a colleague and friend writes that Mrs. Stafford might be the one and most humble person she knows. And because of this, she has the ability to take a low-achieving student and help them see greatness in themselves, as well as make the gifted student who wants to achieve more and not take themselves too seriously. Mrs. Stafford has presented at many conferences, including the Virginia Math Conference, Instructional Showcase, and countless opt-outs, striving to ignite her passion into other teachers. Students write, and I quote, "Miss Stafford, you are so sweet, you're the best teacher ever. Mrs. Stafford makes me feel happy. And on a personal note, Mrs. Stafford is a coffee person." That's a little random, but okay. And then finally, one student writes, "The thing I like best about Miss Stafford is everything." Elizabeth Betsy Stone displays her student artwork in the hallways of Claude Thompson. This leaves quite an impression on her students. One student writes, "Mrs. Stone will put our artwork in the hallway so that other kids can admire our work and see how talented we are." Mrs. Stone selects books to teach her lessons, emphasizing the various styles of the illustrators who create the pictures. She freely gives of her own talents through teaching, creating stage props and backdrops for special events, and designing signs and bulletin boards. She doesn't stop there, however. She is involved with the 24 math competition, Battle of the Books, Habitat for Humanity, the Art Club, Student Council Organization, Multiple Culture Night, and many fundraisers. Her principal, Mrs. Warder, writes that Mrs. Stone engages her students with a variety of strategies and features different artists each month, so her students have the opportunity to open their eyes to many art techniques and cultures from around the world. Mrs. Warder adds that Mrs. Stone has a very big heart, opening her art doors for the staff and students to play with leftover clay and make everyone feel like they have talent. Thank you. Jane Turner's caring attitude, strong sense of values, professional ethics, willingness to listen to her young students, and 36 years of experience escalates her to the top of her profession. Mr. McDaniel, principal at Pierce, writes that her knowledge as a kindergarten teacher is founded on her love of teaching. She is a firm believer that every student can learn and succeed, and she is successful at laying the critical educational groundwork for her students. Mrs. Hoover, assistant principal, writes that Mrs. Turner is not satisfied to rely on just her years of experience, but is always striving to improve and be the best teacher she can be. Her calm, even demeanor creates an environment of trust where students are willing to take risks and push themselves to high achievement. Ms. Turner knows her students and their families with help, which helps her to reach each of her students' individual needs and gives them a great start to their school career. Parents write that Ms. Turner is their children's favorite, and her willingness to take on new challenges and modify her teaching methods based on the personalities of her students demonstrates her expertise and how much she cares for each child. Her colleagues write that Ms. Turner never expects recognition, but her loyalty, energy, kindness, and dedication deserve her being honored. Sarah Ventresco is not only a first grade teacher at Greenville Elementary, but an eternal optimist. She encourages teamwork and cheering each other on in both her classroom and with her first grade team. Mrs. Ventresco leads the Fresh initiative at Greenville and started the running club to get kids moving. Her principal, Mr. Gardner, writes that Mrs. Ventresco inspires a passion in her students for learning. She believes in every child and sees the good in each of her students and the potential for what they can become. Mrs. Ventresco is a dedicated teacher who provides her students with constant positive reinforcement and opportunities to showcase their individual abilities. A colleague writes that Mrs. Ventresco has a gentle way of nurturing each child and models kindness while promoting good citizenship and respect for others. Mrs. Ventresco is always looking for ways to build community in school. She engages staff in games, supports any colleague who needs help, and encourages everyone. Mrs. Ventresco motivates her students to work hard, strives for more, and never to settle for anything less than their very best, and to enjoy themselves along the way. Congratulations. Will you please join me one more time in recognizing our outstanding nominees?
I think I want a group hug here. Everybody squeeze in. Squeeze in as tight as you can there.
Family, Career, and Community Leaders of America. It's a co-curricular club that I sponsor. It's nationwide. It's a leadership type club, and actually we meet every Thursday, and each Thursday is designated for different activities. The first one is our business meeting, the Robert's Rules of Order and all that. Right. Mm-hmm. And then our second is working on competition activities. Third, we go to the Fauquier Food Bank and stock shelves. And then the fourth is our kind of fun meeting where they typically get to bake something and eat it. So that's big, big news. So, but what we would like to present to you, go ahead, guys, and Dr. Jack as well. We have zebra jumbo cupcakes, and they were baked. They were baked in a fashion that when you cut them open, they are black and white, so they will look like zebra print. And then they're topped with a banana icing and an edible glitter, as well as some stripes, of course, because zebras have stripes. So please enjoy. And again, thank you very much for the opportunity for us once again to be able to provide you with a reception. So thank you. Thank you. And thanks, Coach. There you go. All righty. And then Becky, this is our new fax teacher here at Fauquier High School. This is Becky Hale. And she is actually teaching a section of culinary arts as well. And we're kind of working together to make sure that we've got the schools all together on the same page. So we're making some fluency and some continuity within the county. And Becky's group actually made the punch tonight, the cheesecake minis, and the apple roses. So, and again, Becky Hale, and she's here. So thank you very much.
All right. Mm-hmm. All right.
Thank you.
Nice job. Thank you. I don't know about being how we rank as a school division or school board, but we certainly are the best fed school board around. There's no doubt about that.
That's Chick-fil-A, get it?
Nice. My pleasure. Yeah, exactly. All right. Well, let's keep this moving. We will go into announcements. The Mountain Vista Governor School Governing Board meeting scheduled for February 16th has been canceled. The ACES meeting is Thursday, February 23rd at 4:15 in the Central Complex A2 room. There will be a CIP joint work session with the School Board and Board of Supervisors Tuesday, February 21st at 5 p.m. in the Warren Green Meeting Room. There will be a building committee meeting on Thursday, February 23rd at 8:30 a.m. in the school administration conference room. There will be a school board meeting and work session on Monday, February 27th at 6 p.m. in the school administration conference room. A budget public hearing will begin at 7 p.m. The School Health Advisory Committee will meet on Wednesday, March 1st at 8 a.m. in the Central Complex Building Conference Room. There will be a Fauquier Excellence in Education Foundation meeting Thursday, March 2nd at 4:30 p.m. in the School Administration Conference Room. There will be a Special Education Advisory Committee meeting on Thursday, March 2nd at 5:30 in the Central Complex Building A Conference Room. There will be a personnel committee meeting on Thursday, March 9th at 8 a.m. in the school administration conference room. The finance committee will meet Monday, March 13th at 5 p.m. in the Liberty High School conference room. And the next regular school board meeting will be Monday, March 13th at 6:30 p.m. in the Liberty High School auditorium, when the board will recognize first term achievements and the tree nominees. Any changes to those?
No.
All right, well, let's move into citizens' time. Community involvement is an important component of a successful school division, and the school board welcomes public input. There is no back and forth dialogue during citizens' time. However, ideas and concerns brought to the board this evening may be referred to the appropriate administrators for future information, research, and response when needed. Please be respectful of all speakers and limit your comments to 3 minutes. When I call your name, please step to the podium and state your name and magisterial district. If you have any comments, please send them to clerk@fcps1.org for distribution to all the school board members. Thank you. And you can see Ms. Callahan up front if you need more of that information. Tonight we have two people signed up to speak. If there's anybody else that would like to, please come up here after the second speaker speaks. But could we please have BJ Brown from the Cedar Run District speak? And Mr. Hall, you are next.
I wish my comments were on something better, considering what a beautiful start we had. Unfortunately, I'm here about a very serious topic. My name is BJ Brown, and currently numerous legislative studies and bills concerning the ADHD epidemic and the lack of breaks, recess, and PE are in legislators around the country. States have become aware of the unsustainable pressure on their budgets due to ADHD. As many as one-third of all boys in certain areas of Virginia have been diagnosed with ADHD. Use of psychostimulants can automatically disqualify one from military service. We now have epidemics in misdiagnosed ADHD, bipolar, and autism. Due to the weakened criteria in the mental health manual called the DSM, the resulting cost is now necessary for educational assistance and mental health treatments for ADHD and other childhood mental illnesses exceeding $52 billion annually. Right now, there are over 6.4 million children in the United States that are diagnosed with ADHD, and 65% of them are taking psychostimulants as treatment. The side effects of these drugs have caused increasing numbers of individuals to end up in jails, state hospitals, juvenile detention centers, placed on Medicaid, Medicare, and Social Security disability. Due to the weakening of the DSM, and this is according to the founder and the original architect, DSM-4 now allows normal differences in childhood temperament to be diagnosed as a mental disorder due to weak DSM criteria. The pharmaceutical industry's efforts to expand its market have been aided greatly by the expansion of the listing of mental health disorders contained within the DSM, the principal reason for which was to ensure that treatments would be reimbursable by health insurers, Medicaid, and Medicare. The approval of direct-to-consumer advertising has also benefited Big Pharma in this regard. Nearly 57% of the doctors and editors who wrote DSM-4 had financial ties to the pharmaceutical industry. Nearly 70% of the doctors and editors who wrote DSM-5 had financial ties to the pharmaceutical industry. The ADHD epidemic is also due in part to No Child Left Behind. The requirements of No Child Left Behind have significantly increased the demands placed upon children, schools, and families by triggering the decrease or outright removal of break times, recess, and PE from school schedules and the increase of homework, testing, and academic pressure. No Child Left Behind took effect in 2003. 2005 to 2009, disruptive behavior disorders were the most common diagnosis in child and adolescent antipsychotic visits, mostly involving males. This was due to children not being able to sit all day without adequate breaks and balanced schedules. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And does Ms. Callahan have your comments? Thank you so much. Ryan Hall, will you please come forward?
Good. Excuse me, I'm a little nervous. I've never been a part of this. I'm not quite sure how this works. And I can't follow zebra cakes, so that's tough, you know.
Maybe we'll eat.
I missed out on that one. All right.
Eat while you talk.
I'm here to discuss the grade rule of eighth graders playing in high school athletics. The rule currently states that students must be enrolled in the last four years of high school. The exemption to that rule, which is 28-2-2, says the student may be in a sub-varsity level while in eighth grade. However, no student below the eighth grade level is eligible. A student may participate in Virginia High School League sub-varsity sports for 1 year only prior to the entering the ninth grade, so just the eighth grade year. It's my understanding that Fauquier County has a ruling stating that my eighth grade son next year, he's in seventh grade this year, won't be allowed to participate in freshman or JV level sports at the local high school. He's currently in seventh grade at Cedar Lea. Next year will be his eighth grade, I guess, eighth year playing with the kids that he's played with and the coaches that he's had. He's, because he's a bigger kid, genetics involved, he is played with kids that are a year older than him, since he, even 2 years older than him, since he was 6 years old. And so having him go into the rest of his friends and his coaches move to the high school level, which they will next year, he's kind of left in an odd space. And we built a lot of trust with that coach. We built a lot of trust with the local community. I don't have a lot of trust for a lot of the youth programs in the area. They demand a lot of evening time, which is important for my family. They demand a lot of weekend time, which is important for my family. And I just, you know, as somebody that had participated in high school sports in eighth grade, my father was a coach, my parents were teachers, it was important to my understanding what it was going to be like in high school. It brought a lot to the table. You know, I knew going into ninth grade what was expected of me. It took away a lot of transitioning. That ninth grade year where you just go in and you're awkward. I'm sorry, I'm stuttering, so. You know, it's, the rest of the state, it's practiced pretty widely. My dad's a coach at Potomac Falls. He has eighth graders play for him all the time. Tennis, basketball, and football. So it's not uncommon for it to happen. There's no higher risk of injury. You know, the grade point average of those kids, they're held at a little bit to a higher standard than you would if you were playing youth sports. So I don't see many disadvantages to it. Based off conversations that I've had with the coaches that would be involved and some of the teachers that would be involved, he wouldn't be taking away any opportunities from ninth graders, which is pretty important. You know, I don't want my kid to take the place of a ninth grader who's got to get cut. And then also, it's well understood that if my son doesn't make the grade and it's not going to be safe for him to play, he would be asked to not be on the team. And that's understandable. You know, it may give an unfair advantage to the kids that do get to go in at eighth grade. Those kids there, they get to go in and have an extra year in the high school system, and they're that much further along in ninth grade for other things, schooling, recruiting, and stuff like that. Not that my son would ever be involved in that. I just think it's a good program for him. It creates a closer tie to the community for my family. And for my son to be involved at the high school level, at the least, I would ask that there'd be some type of case by case basis, where you could maybe rule and give waivers for certain kids, whatever that might be, whatever you guys came up with. And I do have verbal agreements with the local coaches and the local principal at the school saying that they would support this. That they have no argument with this being done. So, sorry for taking extra time. I'll give my notes to her.
Yeah,
sorry. Shake your voice.
Great. Great job. And if you can make sure your contact information as well is given to Ms. Callahan.
And thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you. Is there anybody else? Okay. Not seeing anybody else, we're going to move on to reports. Board members may report on liaison activities and committee meetings. We're going to start with Mr. Mason.
As long as don't mind.
All right. So you're going to defer? Okay. Mr. Bland?
Well, I was first going to start by saying congratulations to Fauquier High School's wrestling team for winning the 4A West Region title this past weekend. They narrowly beat crosstown rivals Liberty Eagles 184.5 to 183. But from what I understand, as a result of some late great breaking news, there was some scoring corrections made this afternoon, and the two teams are now co-champions. So congratulations to Fauquier and to Liberty. I see your hand up back there. Was that a thumbs up? Okay, thumbs up. Mountain Vista's Governor School held a parent-student information meeting at the Warrington campus of the Lord Fairfax Community College last month. And again, the turnout was tremendous. Like last year, there was standing room only, and very little of that. Thanks to Dr. Williamson and her staff for a well-organized event and a job well done. Also, I would like to take the opportunity to say thank you to Dr. Williamson for being a guest speaker at the Marshall Business and Residents Association meeting last month. She was a guest speaker and did an outstanding job of highlighting the many great accomplishments of Fauquier, Liberty, and the Kettle Run students, all of those students that are attending the Mountain Vistas Governor School. Let's see. I would also like to thank Dr. Jack and Frank Finn for inviting me to be part of a discussion group on substance abuse prevention, education, and treatment among the students here in the county. This group was comprised of local law enforcement leaders, school officials, members of the Mental Health Association, Fauquier Health, the Cadre, the CRUSH organization, members of the clergy, and many more. The discussion centered around what is currently in place or what is in the planning stages for both the school division and community groups in four specific areas: early intervention and prevention, public awareness and reduction of stigma around mental illness and substance abuse, support education for parents, and improved treatment options. Also during that meeting, we were afforded the opportunity to pick up some of these pamphlets. Together There Is Hope. It's a resource guide for addiction services. And I understand that we will be getting these into schools if they're not there already. And we also hope to have this incorporated into our website. It was a great meeting. A lot of ideas exchanged, a lot of discussion. Also, to close, I would like to remind everybody that Marshall Middle School is having their Science and Engineering Fair on March the 20th. Donations are needed. All donations, whether large or small, are greatly appreciated and are used to sponsor student projects for those unable to purchase the necessary materials on their own, and for providing awards at the awards, ribbons, and medals at this event. So if you can give or donate, please do so freely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Sloan?
Thank you. We just came out of our finance meeting, and I know Mr. Shrestha is going to talk through several things, but just to highlight for the board, you remember we deferred the purchase of the school buses due to the salary that we weren't able to do for our percentage for our teachers. We had to, remember our fine governor cut the budget, and unfortunately some of the money that we had hoped to be able to purchase buses at the beginning of the school year, we had to defer. So he'll talk about that, but we are ready to go ahead with the two purchases of those school buses now that we've talked about. So he'll discuss that. And he found some money. He's always finding money for us. He found some money in the fuel cost savings. Okay. So it's kind of exciting that I think we've all noticed that it's been a little bit cheaper to buy gas as we're filling up our own cars, and then just some signing changes that we made. And Mr. Mason and I are both on the finance committee now, as Chairman Gorg has moved on to a different committee. So those were the only changes that are coming up, and I think he'll have a number of other things to report, but those are the two big things coming up now. Thanks.
My turn. Let's see. We did not have personnel meeting, so building committee. Just a couple of things. The sewage treatment plant at Mary Walter, that's plans are still works in the works, and hopefully that work will be done this summer if all goes according to plan. And you can remember we were we tested water at we had two schools where we had some issues, so we will retest at Smith and Pierce, and then over the next couple of months, and then continue to voluntarily test at our other schools during the next
3, 4 months, 5 months, whatever. Parks and Rec Co-op, just a couple of things. You know, we've been talking about these trail projects, it seems like forever, and we're still talking about these trail projects. Some of them have gone out. They're still at VDOT, let me put it that way. Some of them have gone to VDOT for review. The timber fence we thought was a done deal, and then I think it's now back, and something's going to happen with that, and we're going to talk about that. I think even Mr. Livesey's going to talk with us tonight. The timber fence is through. And the grounds maintenance plans, we are continuing to look at how we can make that better so that we don't have three groups covering the same pieces of ground. So hopefully we can improve on that. I just want to give a shout out to Mr. McDonald and his staff for working through this OCR complaint and the amount of time and effort that this is taking, I'm sure is a lot. And lastly, the Cedar Run and Lee District supervisors and school board members, we have been having community meetings. The next one will be March the 15th at Liberty in the Eagle Room. That's a busy night at Liberty. They got lots going on, but if you're out that night and you're at Liberty, drop in. You might learn something, or maybe we can ask. You can ask us a question. So anyway,
good. Dr. Jack,
I have no report.
Okay. I'll just report on a couple of things. Number one, I believe that at our next, this is under the Special Education Advisory Committee, the next work session, we're going to have an information item about a response from staff about suggestions for a survey that we were presented late in the fall, early winter. So hopefully we'll take a look at that and begin moving on that and progressing forward on that. I attended ACES meeting in January and was, you know, there were a lot of topics discussed. Homework continues to come up and be a big topic. It's a big topic across the country, and it's a topic here in our community. So, and it's very impressive the amount of information on both sides of the homework issue. That continues to come up. And lastly, was able to attend Leadership Fakir, which is a group of emerging leaders within our community from all facets and sectors. They had some great input about the schools, if they are any pulse about the rest of the community, people love their schools, and hopefully in all the challenges we have, we continue to see the support of the leaders of this community. So. The staff did an amazing job explaining what we do as a school division and the vision we have for our educational program. So congratulations to all and to those candidates under Leadership Fakir. Great. We will move on to our financial management report. Mr. Shrestha, will you present that? If you can get out.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the board, Dr. Jack. There's no way to make it bigger?
You'll just need to be a colorful speaker.
Okay.
No pressure.
It's fine. This is the financial health report for the school division as of December 31st, and the color codes describe the different funds that we have in the school division. The first group there in the green is our school operating fund. There we go. That looks nice. And so our school operating fund is currently in a positive balance. Revenues are at 47%, which is consistent with prior years. It was reported to the Finance Committee that you'll notice a slight bump in the local funding, and that's due to the fresh grant. Also, federal revenues are slightly behind due to an upgrade that they're doing in the system. Expenditures are at 46%. The next group here is the school asset fund. If we could scroll up in the blue and light blue. This is the fund that we use in the school division to purchase major assets such as buses and also do improvements to buildings and such. This fund is currently at 49%, and it has a positive in revenues, 20% in expenditures as a total of the total appropriated amount, and the fund is in a positive balance. This fund is the money spent in this fund based on projects. The next group here is the textbook fund, and the fund is currently has a $1.2 million balance. Just wanted to point that out to the group. You'll be seeing a presentation in a moment, riveting presentation regarding the textbook fund. So I just wanted to point that out. And no worries, we get state money and local funding every year, so the fund will replenish, and then we will build it up for the next major adoption. And exciting news, as of the turn of the year, our school nutrition fund was turning the corner, and just today we reported in Finance Committee that we're also in a positive balance in the nutrition fund, which is exciting compared to last year. And I'm pretty sure that that has to do with the snow days situation. So that's been a great blessing. In further information, I just wanted to share a little information about what Ms. Sloan mentioned. We proposed in Finance Committee to move forward with the purchase of the two buses. I'm going to work with staff and prepare the materials and make sure that everything's ready. And then in the next Finance Committee meeting, we will finalize that decision and move forward with the final decision. And other than that, I think the remainder will be a discussion of the work session, right?
Okay. Great. Any questions? Thank you. All right, Human Resources Department report, please.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the school board, Dr. Jack. The following is a brief report on human resources during the month of January. We're currently looking for 2.5 certified positions in this current school year. The two bottom positions, speech and language pathologists, school psychologists, and school psychologist interns, we are gearing up for the 2017-2018 school year. Currently, for classified positions, we are really focusing on bus drivers and school nutrition. Recently, we had a transportation hiring fair on February 2nd. We have decided to begin to do these hiring fairs biweekly starting March 2nd, so it would be March 2nd, March 16th, varying between the two locations of Fauquier High School and Liberty High School. In addition, our annual teacher job fair is March 18th, and we're also partnering with the Fredericksburg area, and I believe that's April 29th, and that's with Stafford, Spotsy, and we're getting a big group for teaching recruitment. Any questions this evening? Thank you.
We will move on to consent agenda.
Okay, let's propose minutes from the January 9th organizational and regular school board meeting, the January 19th school board work session, and the January 26th school board work session, the monthly bills and payroll. 9C, the revision of instructional policies 6-1.3, 6-1.5, 6-1.10, 6-1.11, 6-3.6, and 6-3.8. 9D, the revision of student policies 7-4.2. And number 9E, personnel recommendations, including the following: newly hired 5 teachers, 1 special education supervisor, 1 nurse, 2 instructional assistants, 1 business analyst, 1 bus driver, 1 head custodian, and 1 custodian. The resignation of 1 nurse, 1 instructional assistant, and 4 bus drivers, and 1 retired teacher, 1 retired instructional assistant, and 1 retired bus driver.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second for the consent agenda approval, which includes minutes from the January 9th organizational and regular school board meeting, the January 19th school board work session, and the January 26th school board work session, monthly bills and payroll, revision of instructional policies 6-1.3, 6-1.5, 6-1.10, 6-1.11, 6-3.6, and 6-3.8, revision of student policy 7-4.2, and personal recommendations, which include the following: the new and newly hired 5 teachers, 1 special education supervisor, 1 nurse, 2 instructional assistants, 1 business analyst, 1 bus driver, 1 head custodian, and 1 custodian, the resignations of 1 nurse, 1 instructional assistant, and 4 bus drivers, and the retirement of 1 teacher, 1 instructional assistant, and 1 bus driver. Any discussion? Okay.
Oh,
okay. That was on the, okay.
Came late and I didn't get to see it. Okay.
Do I have a motion to amend the consent agenda to include 1 assistant principal?
Friendly amendment offered, sir.
Okay. It's accepted, Ms. Sloan?
Yes.
Okay. With the amendment, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. The motion passes. And we're going to move on to information items. And our first is the addition of a school health advisory committee member. Dr. Jack?
Oh, yes. Judy Olson has been serving on SHAB at least for the last year, but she was never formally adopted as a member of SHAB by the school board, and we're bringing that request to the school board tonight.
Okay. And you would like this to move?
And I see this as a request to move to action.
And she's done several presentations at that meeting that I've seen. So she's
very an excellent
highly involved.
Member. So it's a, she's been a real benefit to SHAB. So.
Okay. Great. All right. If I move that to action item. 10B, information item, Town of Warrenton, Fauquier High School easement. Mr. Livesey.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Dr. Jack. I am here this evening to request the board authorize the chairman to execute the deed conveying title and easements to property at Fauquier High School to the Town of Warrenton for a waterline easement along Waterloo Road. Mm-hmm. The town is requesting a 20-foot easement to install an 8-inch water main to connect water lines from the wharf entrance to the Stonecrest development on the northern edge of Fauquier High School, just up the road here up Waterloo. This connection provides a continuous loop for the town, providing 2 sources of water for Fauquier High School should the town experience an interruption in service from one of the other lines. This easement will run adjacent to Waterloo Road across from the town's Wharf Recreational Center to the Stonecrest development. It will require the removal of some trees. 4 existing pine trees are in the middle of the easement, and the town has agreed to replace those when the easement line or the water line is completed. After reviewing the plans and meeting with town officials, this easement will have no impact to the school division, and if approved, the town expects to begin the work late spring with completion early July 2017. The building committee has reviewed this request and forwards it to you, the board, tonight for consideration. The board is requested to act on this request at this meeting. Budget impact in the future, should the board decide to connect the Thorpe House water and sewer to the town, they've offered to provide a full credit for the cost of the sewer tap fees, the connection fees, and the meter. That credit is worth about $12,544, I believe.
Yes.
It will not include the water tap fees. It's strictly the sewer connection fees at this time. Any questions?
Mr. Chairman, as Mr. Livesey had said, it does move out of the building committee with our full approval.
I just have a question. Is there any impact if something on that trail comes forward to us?
No, what the town has said, and they are just gearing up the timber fence trail again, no specific details as of yet. The timber fence trail will be over top of the waterline easement.
Okay.
So they will not be doing secondary construction.
Good to know.
If the timber fence trail does come to life.
Great. Any other questions? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay, great. We will now see revision of policy 5-7.6 employee absences. Ms. Downs, you?
I can.
You're going to do it?
This is actually a request that came from the good folks at the Fuck Your Education Foundation. Actually, this just puts us in compliance with what the county does now in terms of bereavement leave. The county offers 4 days bereavement leave. We offer three. Ms. Goodson was kind enough to point this out to me. It makes perfect sense that we are in alignment with the county since we are in alignment with so many other areas. I'm going to bring this to the board for approval with the caveats mentioned in the policy, which already exists in the policy. We're just simply adding a day to it. Mm-hmm.
Good.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Everybody okay with consent? I heard about this at the ACES meeting as well and fully support it. So, great. I think on consent. Thank you. Revisions of policy 2-2.3, advertising, sales, and solicitation, and 4-4.1, student transportation services. Ms. Bourne.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Jack. These are two policies that are being revised to be consistent with the Code of Virginia. Changes that were made effective July 1. We've already been doing the one that's 2-2.3. We do this. This gives access to youth organizations such as Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts and other similar organizations an ability to place their materials in our schools so that parents and students can have access to them. And that is something that we do. We also for those schools that offer a back-to-school night that has tables for display, then it would also allow them to have a table. And so the principals are aware of that, and we've been doing it. But this brings the code up to our policy up to date with the code. And then for 4-4.1, student transportation services, a few years ago, the code was amended to allow us to enter into agreements with non-public schools for transportation services to and from school, and this just takes it a step further and allows us to include field trips in those agreements. We do not have any similar agreements, but if we were to do it, it allows us now to have services to and from school as well as field trips. Any questions? And this is for information tonight and then to bring back at your next meeting for action.
Can you reference the code, send us an email about the code for 2-2.3 or 2-2.3?
The actual code section.
I'm just curious if it includes Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts in the code.
It
or
does.
If that's our own language.
It does. I pulled, yes, it does. Actually, yes, yeah. Because we actually had spoken with our attorney, and this came up for us in the summer. In July or August, and so we spoke with our attorney about it at that time, and it is actually in the code that it references. In fact, these are the words directly from the code that we've added to our policy.
Okay.
I think so too.
Odd, but yeah. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm okay with consent.
I'm okay.
Everybody okay with consent? Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, we can always pull it out. All right, elementary reading program adoption. Mr. Payne.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Jack, I'm joined tonight by Ms. Kathy Crane, who's our reading specialist at Coleman Elementary School, and she's one of the members of our elementary literacy program and intervention system adoption, K through 5, for this year. We're placing before you a report that I've prepared, and I just briefly want to say one major thing about it, that it does include a core comprehensive program that's supplemented by a robust word study program. It's being spearheaded by Ms. Crane and a group of our reading specialists. And it also includes fitting our reading labs, fully with materials for interventions for tier two. So if you have any questions, we'll be happy to try to answer them tonight, but look forward to having you look at what we've put before you.
I guess we'll discuss this more further. No, I would definitely like to take this to work session. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Comply. Work session?
27th.
27th, great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Awesome. Great job. I don't know, there were about 50 people on that review committee.
Yeah, that's what I was just looking at. Yeah.
Unbelievable. Okay, Ms. Sloan will present the proposed 2017
okay.
legislative priorities.
Request that the school board approve the proposed 2017 legislative priorities. The school board annually reviews the board's legislative positions prior to the members of the General Assembly's submission of their proposed legislation. And the positions are used to advocate for the issues listed in these priorities with members of the General Assembly and members of the Senate and the Congress. There's a link to the legislative priorities. I don't know if you're going to click on that, Ms. Callahan, but you're welcome to, but it's there for you all to see, and then, of course, printed out here. Now, one of the things I did, and I thought it was important because of the timing. If you look at what's happening in an odd year in our General Assembly in Virginia, it's a short year. Right. So it ends on the last day of February this year. All the bills from both sides have to be, you know, completed by then. Last Tuesday was crossover day. And there kind of is no point in putting them on here if they were defeated in the House or they were defeated in the Senate. So there's a link that I have that I'll send over to you if you want to peek at, you know, kind of what was defeated in the Senate, what was defeated in the House, and then why would we have it as a priority. I did notice when you all did this last year, you did it prior to the session starting. So there may be some discussion next year about, you know, I kind of agree with crossover time to be doing this because you can put a whole bunch of stuff in your proposed ideas and then there goes, everything gets defeated that we were interested in. The other thing I did is I took, you know, you could have a whole, it's 17 pages long of the legislation that's going through and peek at it. Some of the Senate and the House bills are nearly identical, and you'll see those are the ones that they tend to blend together. And you can look if it's a 40-0 vote in the Senate, and then there's a very similar one on the House side, and that one has, you know, almost a unanimous or a unanimous vote. That one's going to get combined probably, and that one's probably going to pass. So I took a lot of those and I blended them together to say kind of general things. Otherwise you'd have, right, you'd have 17 pages of priorities that I don't know that we want to be sifting through. So that's what you'll see tonight is kind of a combination of those and then putting things together that seem to make sense just by my time over the last 7 years in Richmond, some things that I think maybe a good idea, but I bet that one's not going to pass because it keeps coming up, and every year it seems to get defeated at the end, or our governor will veto again, which has happened in the past, too. This was the highest number of vetoes ever by a Virginia governor. So I kind of put them in cluster areas. So if you think about programs and accountability, this last one that was the grading policy, you remember there was a big talk about this last year. There are no bills at all talking about that grading policy, that A through F. That was not supported by the Virginia superintendents, the VSBA, the VEA. No one was supporting that. So what I did here is, should it happen, if a uniform grading policy is mandated, even though the bills aren't there, we would want the VDOE with local school board representation to review those should that come up again. But that won't come up in this 2017 session before the last day of February. The second one talks about the profile of a Virginia graduate. We believe the board and local school divisions need time and flexibility to implement these reforms. And if you want a reference, there's actually a bill that passed unanimously that said, let's defer that a year and give some time, because I think Dr. Jack and I have had some discussion, and he probably has with some of his colleagues. Great ideas, love the changes, but don't mandate things to start July 1st, and we won't have the money to pay for it. We support the work of the Virginia Board of Education to identify and implement revised assessment and accountability model. They're always doing that. There's always something to change. You know, 2 years ago, we had a reduced number of SOL tests that I think everybody, teachers, parents, kids, applauded. So we want to be sure that we support any of those changes, but we also want to be sure that individual schools and school divisions and the community needs are looked at and the diversity of student population before you make changes. Also, the last one in that category talks about local school divisions' ability to adjust and adapt their career and technical education programs to better meet the changing workforce. Mr. Mason and I have attended a webinar on that, and I think the whole board agrees that there are some changing workforce needs that will probably have some changes that our House and Senate will support, and now we want the funding to follow. So that's what I put here for supporting additional state funding to allow those local school divisions to make those decisions. We have never been affected really negatively about the school calendar, but you know, we've all been in the meetings where they talk about the calendar changing. So there is a House bill that did go through talking about allowing, again, the local school division to determine their needs, their school calendar, including an extended day, extended year, year-round school options, without having to go ahead and request a waiver. And there does seem to be quite a bit of support for that, and certainly our VSBA supports that. And then, you know, this was just kind of a general, if you can look, there are several bills that talk to this. So putting it together, we would oppose any legislation which divests local school boards of their constitutional authority to supervise schools and interfere with the day-to-day activities of school boards and superintendents as they perform their constitutional responsibility. I would say there are probably 12 bills that talk about this. And basically, we're opposing anything that takes away the local school board control of what happens in our school division. And that's pretty common. Funding, we can support it and hope for it, but changing the composite index formula has been, up there forever. We'll just keep cutting and pasting that every year and just think that it might happen. We'd like it to reflect the taxable value of the land rather than the fair market value. And then, of course, we asked the General Assembly to support funding for school divisions for specialized training, professional development, maximum SOQ flexibility to go with the resources, needs, and demands, and expand funding to support broadband, support technology infrastructure, and to close the technology resource gap between students in poverty and other students. And I know we grapple with that in Fauquier County. The second page talks about VRS. Again, we can support this and hope for this, but again, I think we all agree we'd like it to go back to the timeline set in 2012. We'd like to retain the critical funding that was allocated to the local school divisions to support that state share of the 2% salary increase for the SOQ-funded positions. We oppose vouchers and tuition tax credits for non-public schools. We support full funding of all mandates and programs passed by the General Assembly. Full funding, partial funding, or absence of fundings for mandates and programs results in additional burden on school divisions. We support the Board of Education's recommendation to remove the SOQ support position cap. They were going to try to put a cap on that. Support service positions are essential to the effective operation of Fauquier County schools. They provide vital support to instructional staff. By capping those, you're taking away things that our children need. And then, of course, we want additional state funding to allow school divisions to adjust and adapt career and technical education programs. We oppose any cutting of current levels of public education funding to maintain quality and better prepare Virginia students for higher education and global economic competition. The last one I kept in there and just reworded a bit, but there are no bills in here on this particular topic, which is that re-benchmarking methodology. Any setting of caps, again, with support personnel, we would oppose that, any caps that they would be sending. And then the last one, again, with the charter school, should it pass, I do think you'll have a veto by the governor, but it's still here saying we support monitoring any changes to the current charter school law in order to assure that it continues to be limited to public schools and that local school boards retain authority and control over those schools. But it's not something to be concerned about. It's not going to pass. If it passes, it'll get vetoed. So that summarizes kind of the 17 pages there in a 5-minute spiel. Hopefully that's good.
Good job. Thank
you.
Wow. Yeah. Thank you, Suzanne.
Yeah, sure.
That's proposed
move to action.
What did he say?
Can you repeat all that?
Yeah.
Sure. Ready to go. Programs are kind of about that.
Okay. Thank you. All right, well.
You want a motion?
Yes, I would like a motion.
I will move that the school board move information items 10A, 10B, and 10F to action items 11B, 11C, and 11D, respectively, for consideration for approval this evening.
Second.
Excuse me. There's been a motion and a second that the school board move information items 10A, 10B, and 10F to action items 11B, 11C, and 11D, respectively, for consideration this evening. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. And the motion passes. And we move on to action items.
Mr. Chair, I motion that the school board support the Middle School Modernization Committee's recommendation for a consolidated school on the Teller site.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second that the school board support the Middle School Modernization Committee's recommendation for a consolidated school on the Taylor site. Any discussion?
I'd just like to, again, thank everybody that put so much time and effort into serving on that committee. And I would encourage everybody to speak to your supervisors and let them know how you feel about this. Right now it does not look good. So if you feel strongly, if you think that it's time that we do something about those two aging schools, please let your supervisors know. It's extremely important.
Any other discussion?
You can call or email. I know I received some emails sent to the Board of Supervisor member for the Scott District and then copied me. So that's great to have both on there. Emails are good.
Great. Yeah. I would simply add this is part of a process. Governing is about process so many times. And although this may not be, or could be, hopefully, but may not be the direction that we ultimately end up going in, this is part of the process. And this school board, along with 40 some other people on that committee, believe that this is the best value and best decision for students and for the taxpayers of this community. So although the reality may not allow us to do this, we're not sure. We'll still put forward what we believe is the best option for this community, for the students now, and for decades into the future. So, okay. There's been a motion and a second that the school board report, that the school, well, actually, we've already read that. Any discussion? We've had the final discussion.
Yeah.
Sorry. Long night. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. And the motion passes. Adoption of the school health advisory committee member.
I move that the school board approve the addition of Judy Olson to the school health advisory committee.
Second.
A motion and a second that the school board approve the addition of Judy Olson to the school health advisory committee. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, no. And the motion passes. The Warren, Town of Warrenton, Fauquier High School, okay. Easement.
Mr. Chair, I motion that the school board authorize the school board chairman to execute a deed of easement, granting an easement on Fauquier High School property along Waterloo Road to the Town of Warrenton for the purpose of installing and maintaining a water line.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second that the school board authorize the school board chairman to execute a deed of easement granting an easement on Fauquier High School property along Waterloo Road to the Town of Warrenton for the purpose of installing and maintaining a water line. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, no, and the motion passes. And legislative priorities.
I move that the school board adopt the proposed 2017 legislative priorities.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second that the school board adopt the proposed 2017 legislative priorities. Any discussion?
Thank you, Suzanne.
Yes, thank you. Great job. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, no. And the motion passes. Great. At this time, we're going to move into budget work session. Mr. Shrestha has a couple updates on two amendments from the General Assembly that may not really impact us that much, but he just wanted to give those updates. Absolutely. And then at this time, we can ask any questions of Mr. Stressa or Dr. Jack about the budget. So let's hear these two first, and if we have any questions that are still outstanding, we can ask those.
Hi, good evening. For your consideration and information during this budget work session, I just wanted to offer some analysis of how the House bill and the Senate bill may impact us at the macro level. From a numbers perspective, the biggest change is occurring and in the area of lottery funding. And in the House bill, for example, the compensation is not being increased in the line item, but we are receiving more lottery funding. And then there's a lot of minor adjustments. So in terms of receiving more funding for us as a school division, it appears that the House bill may be the one that may help us get a little more funding. But it's not substantial in terms of a $136 million budget. It would probably be a very small amount, depending on how it panned out. Now, the Senate bill, what it does is reduces our lottery funding. And just as an FYI, the lottery funding, if you recall last year, the rule was that we needed to use half of that money for only one-time costs. And so they've kind of eased back on that rule, and we can use it for anything related to, instruction or in the school division. But what's happening in the Senate side is that amount will go down, and they're funding this compensation. Right, but in our case, in Fauquier County, we have moved forward with the 2%, and that was not taken away from our employees. So all of these discussions about a 1.5% bonus or anything else are not consequential in terms of what we have done, because we've already moved forward with the 2%. Okay. And that's basically what I have as far as additional information. And as far as the work session, this is really an opportunity for you as a board to discuss. If you have any questions, we can try to answer those questions, or if we can't answer them right now, we'll respond. I know that in the last work session, there was a question about the transportation management system, and that presentation is scheduled for the 27th. So our staff is putting that together for you, and that will be a presentation to the entire board. Do you have any questions? Or I can retire and...
Why don't we just go down the line? Mr. Mason, do you have any questions? Mr. Bland.
I'm just glad that they're going to remove the restraints saying that, we have to use it on one-time type funding. Now we have the opportunity to move it or spread it across the whole operational field. We have some say in how we propose to do it. Although it may not be much, but anything we get is going to be good.
Did I read something about again? They're talking about raises for teachers.
Yes. Bonuses, right? In the form of bonuses.
Well, something said bonuses, but something said raises, I thought.
Yes, ma'am. So what has been introduced is essentially the original FY17 budget included a 2%, was asking school divisions to provide a 2% compensation increase for SOQ supported positions.
Right.
And if that was done by December 16th, the state would basically match. It was incentive money.
Right.
What happened to many school divisions is school divisions moved forward that 2%, and then it was announced that we would not receive that funding,
right?
But the state actually removed that funding, so as state employees did not receive any sort of compensation increase. And what's happening now in the second year of the biennium is that in lieu of, let's pretend that we did not give any compensation increase, there's a 1.5% bonus being introduced. But we have already given the 2% increase. So it doesn't apply. I mean, it doesn't apply in the way that it's not an additional amount. So, Dr. Jack, did you have anything?
Yeah, else? Well, another way of looking at this is over the biennium, we're losing $900,000 that was earmarked for that 2% raise, that match. So that was the total loss over the biennium. The majority of that money is in the second year of the biennium. So this is something that Richmond does all the time, unfortunately. So they'll come out with a press release about a 1.5% bonus or some other sort of compensation package. But in the end, you know, we're talking about for the 1.5%, when it all washes out, $300,000. Well, we're down $900,000. So it's really a difference between going from 900,000 down to 600,000 down. If the Senate, the House of Delegates bill, for example, is the one that was adopted. So, and it's just a shame, I think, and I explained this to Liz in our last meeting, when the state puts this out there, the average individual on the street is not following this stuff carefully. They see that and they assume that, great, we're going to get a one. It doesn't work that way. Because it's SOQ funded, first of all, positions only, which are like 60 to 70% of our positions, and it's linked to our composite index. So thanks for pointing that out. That's important to know because it's confusing, and I hate to say it. I think sometimes it's intentionally confusing. They're trying to put a positive spin on this issue. There really is no positive. Both of these bills, when they shake out, there's a minimum benefit for us. I mean, if we end up with $100,000 extra, we'll be fortunate. Would you agree with that, based on what we got today?
Yes, sir.
It's somewhat misleading, I think.
So you're saying there's alternative facts?
No comment.
Alternative facts provided, I believe.
But I think it might be. Just
Sorry.
To put it in context, it might be another important piece of information. A 1% across the board increase for our school division is approximately $1 million. That's not the amount that we would be getting from the state in any case. So it would still not be sufficient to make up what we would need to even do a 1%.
Ms. Sloan, do you have any questions?
We're answered in the other session. Thanks. I've been peppering him.
I have one more question. Professional development, could that be considered ongoing expense or one-time expense if it's used? If we
wanted to create a program, it would be an ongoing.
It would not be, okay.
And it would be something that we would work closely with HR and develop a program, possibly a policy for you as a board to consider. If that's something that we want to look at in the future.
We do professional development. It's just if we used some of that one-time money on additional professional development for the first year.
Oh, yeah, that would be one time. Okay. If we were just to designate some of the extra money for that, yes, sir. I'm sorry, misunderstood.
That's all right. I just have concerns about the professional development opportunities, particularly since we're not giving raises. And, that answered my question. Thank you. All right. Move on. Thank you so much.
Hey, thanks.
All right. Move. Entertain a motion for closed session.
I'll move that the school board convenes a closed meeting for the purpose of discussing and considering a student discipline matter pursuant to Virginia Code Section 2.2-3711A, subsection 2.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second that the school board convenes a closed meeting for the purpose of discussing and considering a student discipline matter pursuant to Virginia Code Section 2-2-3711A, subsection 2. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. We're in closed session. Thank you all for coming tonight.